I'm Matt, and this is Not Enough Seconds. Today we're talking about automated stirs, or automated lights for stirs to be precise. So if you want them for under $20, follow me to my office. Alright, much better. At least I know what I'm doing in here, more or less. First of all, thanks to banggood.com for sponsoring this, and because it's a Black Friday today, you could probably get the components even cheaper, make it less than $20 or maybe even $15. I'm gonna list the components in the description with a link to the Banggood sale as well, so go and check it out. Today we're gonna focus on the hardware aspect of this build. In a previous video, if you've not seen it, we were talking about the design. Today we're focusing about the hardware. And once I finish tweaking, we're gonna focusing about the software itself to make it work as you want. So I guess let's get started. Let's start by taking our trunking and measuring equal distance between LEDs. In my circumstances, I've got 2 meters of trunking times two, and I need LEDs to be 30 centimeters apart for each step, and then one in between to make it a little bit denser. So that's what I'm going to do inside of the thin piece of trunking. I'm just gonna mark out the distances every 30 centimeters and then every 15 centimeters. That should allow me to have 2 LEDs per step. Once all the holes are marked on the inside, it's time to start drilling. A few words of advice, I've used 10mm drill for wood. It worked well. 8mm should work as well. So do this, do the holes, and then clean them up with knife or something. Now, next step is just to mark inside which direction the LED is going to be facing on both pieces of trunking, just to not to get confused later on. Also, at this point, I've measured everything on the wall, and it was time to shorten the trunking just a tiny little bit. I'm going to use it later on, the fragment to house the Arduino itself. As you can see, I also preparing the mounting holes, just 5 holes per each. Now, I can test the LEDs to make sure they're working and I'm not fixing any broken LEDs. As you can see, the LEDs are working fine. The one last two aren't for some reason. But then I'm gonna test another set. And yeah, they're all working fine. I think it's just a software problem. So my LED strip comes with adhesive. I have to strip that off first to expose the pins. Make sure you've got access to the contact points of both ends, because this is where we're gonna solder in all the wires. These strips are too densely populated, obviously, for this purpose. Therefore, I'm going to cut them into pieces, and I need a total of 26 pieces to fill in for all the steps and in between the steps. So just cut them into pieces and we're gonna prep them for soldering. Before you solder any wires into the LEDs, it's a good idea just to prep the parts as well. So what I'm going to do is just take a bit of solder, and on every individual part on 3 contact points, I'm just gonna leave a small blip of a solder. It's gonna make it so much easier later on to solder in the wires. And remember, we're soldering on the backside of the LED. When you finish with this step, you can also cut the wire into small pieces to make sure everything is ready for later assembly. It's time to put the LEDs inside the trunking. Be mindful of the orientation. Use the previously made markings to orient LEDs correctly. They all have to face the same way. What I'm doing here is just adding a tiny bit of hot glue on top of the contact points and then sticking them down to the trunking. Hot glue is perfect for that because LED is very light and it's unlikely to move. There is a little bit of flexibility there, and obviously it takes only a few seconds to do it. Repeat this step for every single hole you've made for the LED. Now we are heading to the most painstaking task ever, which means every LED has to be connected by 3 wires, the positive, the ground, and the data. So yeah, start soldering. I'm sorry to say, but this is the most boring bit of the entire build, and it's also the most lengthy one as well. It took me about 2 hours to do it, both trunkings. I guess this is what you get when you want to do things on a chip, right? When you're soldering the cables, keep the color consistency, because it's gonna make it so much easier later on, especially when trying to identify cables sticking outside of the trunking.
More on this later. I probably don't have to mention that, but hey, I'm gonna mention it anyway. Make sure all the contacts are soldered correctly and you solder correct wires to correct terminals, because otherwise you might end up destroying your LEDs. When the soldering is complete, what we have to do is just add the connection points. Connection points on the one side will allow you to join multiple trunking together. I've used the jumper cables, so I could easily connect them and I don't have to have them soldered permanently. And the other side, the top side, is gonna have just a positive and negative for the sensor, to power up the sensor. You can use actually the same rail. Now check the wires, there shouldn't be really much slack on it, just a tiny little bit. Secure all the wires with the hot glue so it wouldn't get snagged in between the trunking once you're closing it up. Add additional wire across that's gonna serve as a data cable from the PRR sensor to the Arduino itself, and secure it with the glue as well. Just allow glue to set and make sure all the cables are neatly stored, as if you snag the cable, it's possible to actually cut it through and then you have to redo some of the soldering, so it's worth of paying attention. Assemble the trunking, and once the trunking is assembled, just give it a test so you would know if everything is alright. So you can see I've got two trunkings here for the total of 4 meters, and gonna connect them both together. And just to confirm that they're working, because otherwise I would have to go back and repeat this step. So I've used jumper cables on one side, the female headers on the other side, the male headers, and that helps me basically connect them together and transport it. Everything works great, and I'm ready to do the fitting. I've 3D printed the housing for the sensor. I'm going to measure how much space it needs on my wall before bolting down the trunking itself. I'm using the deep trunking for the wall. To bolt it down, I'm using a dry plaster screws, which are a little bit wider than the wooden screws, and just aim for the short ones. I've got 25 mil screws and they work just fine, and the trunking is very stable and firm. At that time, I didn't know how big is gonna be my enclosure for PRR sensors, so my trunking ended up being slightly too long and I had to cut the trunking shorter and remove one of the LEDs. If you already know the length of the sensor itself and the enclosure, and obviously the length of the stairs, you can do this step when actually drilling holes into the trunking and save yourself potentially a little bit of trouble there. Note that all the trunkings ends are tapered to one angle, so they would fit nicely and create a perpendicular angle to the floor. And the last piece of advice, always try to get a screw next to the end of the trunking to avoid the trunking from wobbling around, so that's the best way to do it. When snapping the LEDs back on the trunking rail itself, make sure you won't snag any cables. This is quite important. You'll see the cables are prepared for the PRR sensor already. I'm gonna plug them in a second, and then attach the rail on one side and start pressing down until you get to the very bottom of it. I've also shortened one of the mounting brackets a little bit, so that would create a nice end. That way the LED strip and the trunking itself that I'm using as a mounting bracket doesn't end in the same spot, and it's the join is less visible. Repeat the process with a second trunking, connecting the cables first and then sliding in the trunking onto the rail. And my advice, work with the gravity, not against it. So start from the top and then continue to the bottom. I guess it's time to mount the sensors. I've removed the plastic covers from the pins and bent the pins inside a little bit to accommodate for my case and accommodate for the jumpers. They're gonna be bent even further once inside of the enclosure for the PRR sensor. So Once this is mounted, bend the pins a little bit. I also created a small hole inside of it so I could slot my wires through. It's on level with the trunking itself, so you won't be able to see any wires. Make sure you don't snag any wires. I put it on the wall and secure it with two screws. 25 mils is enough to drive through and close itself. Now, by this stage, just make sure you check the settings of the PR sensor, because obviously you want to have a minimum timer and maximum sensitivity and minimum timer. You will notice at the bottom, I'm mounting the PR sensor slightly away from the trunking itself. This is because I'm gonna use an additional piece of trunking to hide Arduino Nano inside, like this. So when I specify the distance, I'm able to put the Arduino inside and then connect all the wires. Now, there are many ways of connecting the wires. You can do the jumpers, you can just hotfix them into Arduino directly, but I've used a small board to connect all the wires, and I'm just going to show you the schematics, how it works. The sketch itself isn't complicated. I'm using a battery as a source of power. It's 5 volts, and you need about 300 milliamps at least, so get yourself a 500 milliamp charger or 1 amp charger and you'll be fine. Both PR sensors are connected directly to Arduino Nano using blue wires on the diagram. That's the data pin going to the digital 4 and digital 3 pins on Arduino Nano. You'll notice that the top sensor is connected, it's powered by LED strip, so you can actually draw power through the LED strip, and I'll save you 2 extra wires to run across the trunking. To power Arduino Nano, I'm using salvaged mini USB cable, which is cut in half, connected to Arduino. That way I'm avoiding powering Arduino via pins itself, because it's less safe this way, so and saves me on some extra wiring, because all I have to do is plug it in and plug it out, and I can remove the Arduino for programming at any given time. I've repurposed old charger and I run the wire across the skirting board, making it barely visible to the Arduino unit. The Arduino is inside and it's powered right now, and it drives the power from the small PCB board that I've used. I've also added a splitter so I could split the cable and remove the Arduino. This is where the power splits into Arduino itself, to the mini USB, and to the board itself that power LEDs and the sensors itself. Now, there are cables in here that are hidden inside, so once everything's done and I'm happy with the animation, I'm just gonna pop the cover and hide all the cables so they wouldn't be visible.
In the next video, we're gonna focus on the software. Right now, everything I've done and show you so far is available in a written form as an article, so you can access it down below in the description of this video. So go and check a look, you're gonna find all the components, all the links for components, all the descriptions, additional pictures, etc. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Follow me on social media if you want to be notified when the final version with the software is out. And obviously subscribe, like this video, share it if you find it cool. I find it cool. And what else? Probably I should mention that you can sponsor me directly, or if you're a company, you can get in touch with me and everything to promote myself. It's the things I do for you guys. Anyway, see you next time. Thank you.